I think an important question we've all been asking ourselves in this last month or two is, as a dental professional, what can we do? I think it's important for everybody to be sure that they're accessing reliable information. We're so fortunate that we have our professional organizations and our government agencies who are providing that information and making sure that it's the most timely and the most accurate. I would suggest checking in with the ADA, the CDC, NIH, and OSAP websites on a regular basis. And if you hear something that you're not sure is correct, you can go and check those sources to confirm it. We really need to avoid panic and rumors. There's a lot of information being circulated that is inaccurate, and in a time like this, that can be dangerous. Take the recommendations from your local, state, and federal public health officials seriously, and heed the numerous calls to temporarily suspend all non-urgent dental appointments until this crisis is over and health officials indicate it's appropriate to resume, and they will give us the types of recommendations that we'll need to resume our operations safely. So why do we need to stop elective procedures? We can't reliably identify patients who are asymptomatically infected or who may be in that incubation period. So we all need to limit our contact with people outside of our immediate circle for a while. And our immediate circle is generally considered to be our household contacts. Many of our dental procedures produce aerosols, and aerosols are known to increase exposure potential if patients are infected and the virus is present in their respiratory fluids. We also know that supplies of PPE for treating sick people in hospitals is currently critically low. And if we use these for non-urgent procedures, we contribute to the risk of our frontline healthcare workers being left unprotected. And these shortages currently have no end date in sight. We're not sure when that supply chain will be restored. The ADA came out with a great source that helps us identify which types of procedures we should continue to offer to our patients. The first are dental emergencies. These dental emergencies are potentially life-threatening and require immediate treatment to stop ongoing tissue bleeding, alleviate severe pain or infection, and they might include things such as uncontrolled bleeding, cellulitis or a diffuse soft tissue bacterial infection with intraoral or extraoral swelling that potentially could compromise the patient's airway. It also includes trauma involving facial bones that potentially compromise the patient's airway. Now, urgent dental care, which we also can provide, focuses on the management of conditions that require immediate attention to relieve severe pain or risk of infection and to alleviate the burden on hospital emergency departments. These should be treated as minimally invasive as possible. So that means, you know, avoiding use of aerosol-producing instruments and devices, and perhaps using temporary materials to control caries that are causing pain to the patient. Urgent dental care includes severe dental pain from pulpal inflammation, pericoronitis or third molar pain, surgical postoperative osteitis, and dry socket dressing changes. It also includes abscesses or localized bacterial infection resulting in localized pain and swelling. It could be a tooth fracture that causes pain or soft tissue trauma, an avulsed or luxated tooth from dental trauma, and treatment that was required prior to critical medical procedures. Also, final crown and bridge cementations can be done if the temporary restoration is lost, broken, or causing gingival irritation. You can also provide care to patients who have extensive dental caries or defective restorations that are causing pain. And you can manage these with interim restoration techniques whenever possible, such as silver diamine fluoride and glass ionomers. Suture removals can continue to be done, as well as denture adjustments on radiation and oncology patients, and denture adjustments or repairs when function is impeded and the patient can't eat. Replacing temporary fillings on endodontic access openings in patients experiencing pain, and also snipping or adjustment of an orthodontic wire or appliance that's piercing or ulcerating the oral mucosa, and biopsy of abnormal tissues should continue. The CDC is providing constant guidance for us in how to safely treat patients and safely be around other people when we absolutely need to provide these vital services. These CDC guidelines are found on their website, and they should be checked regularly because information and needs are emerging, and these guidelines change as those evolve. Right now, the current CDC guidelines call that dental providers should not provide elective procedures in concert with the ADA recommendations. If you must treat emergencies, ask screening questions for respiratory infection, and if the patient has a respiratory infection or has had contact with somebody who's been diagnosed with COVID-19, consider referral to a medical center if available, and if that's not possible and the patient needs to be seen, there are still some things that you can do, and we're going to talk about those. And there have also been some guidelines that have come out from the CDC for optimization of PPE under the current situation where there is a shortage of certain things such as surgical masks. This is only to be used in these critical emergency situations, and it is not to be used for routine dental care or when PPE is available. These measures include things like using a mask for more than one patient. In some situations in hospitals, they're needing to do this because there simply aren't enough masks to treat all the patients. Also, during this time, any available N95 respirators should be prioritized for procedures that are likely to generate respiratory aerosols, which would pose the highest exposure of risk to healthcare professionals. And that is for patients who are confirmed or suspected to have COVID-19, not for well patients. Face masks protect the wearer from splashes and sprays. We should continue to wear face masks and change them between each patient or more often if they become wet. Respirators, which filter inspired air, offer a greater level of protection. They protect the respiratory tract of the wearer. Examples of procedures that produce respiratory aerosols are those likely to induce coughing. And the CDC identifies these as things such as sputum induction and open suctioning of airways. They do not address dental aerosols, and those are not specifically mentioned in respiratory aerosols. So this CDC guidance on optimization of PPE, as I said, things like reuse of a surgical mask or a respirator, is only after all other administrative and work practice controls have been exhausted. Administrative controls do include things such as providing only urgent care, limiting people that are in the facility, using telemedicine, and we'll talk about that in a little while, limiting the procedures in length and in the spread of oral fluids, and please visit the CDC website where there is a full list of administrative and work practice controls that can be implemented to optimize the use of PPE.